lots of people saying, I don't know if I have enough faith for this journey. And I like how in A Course in Miracles, Jesus talks about faith and faithlessness, but he doesn't ever really talk about faith as kind of a more or less thing. He never puts faith on a continuum of small faith or medium faith or great faith. He says faith is really the power of your mind. He said, oh, there's no doubt you have faith. It's kind of like the old thing, be careful what you pray for because you may get it. Well, prayers are answered in the sense that everything in the world reflects your mind, and your mind is where the prayer is. And you could say that your faith is the power of the mind. So it's more a helpful question is, what have I put my faith in? And then when you get into the Course workbook, he gets very specific about, you know, lesson 50, you know, I am sustained by the love of God. He takes the time to put the contrast in. And he says, in this world, you believe you are sustained by everything but the love of God. Pills, money, protective clothing, being liked, knowing the right people, and a list of things that you really have put your faith in. You believe in all these things. And then in a few 26 lessons later, in lesson 76, he goes on, you endow the world with all these abilities and skills, and he talks about, you really believe you would starve unless you had stacks of green paper strips and piles of metal discs. You really believe that fluid pushed through your veins will ward off disease. He talks about the laws of economics. He talks about the laws of friendship. I mean, he gets really specific, and he basically is saying, oh, you've got faith. Faith is not your problem. We share the same mind, so you've got faith. No problem with that. You've got a very, very, very powerful mind, and you've invested it in a lot of ego beliefs. And he's very specific about those beliefs. In fact, when I was doing lesson 50 and lesson 76, that was a bit, you know, he got so specific that I had to spend like a whole week just going off and going, oh yeah, I'm invested. I could see I had misinvested in a very major way. I had taken my faith and I had completely misinvested it. I feel like I read a thing on the stock market today too, and it was just saying how they were saying that most investors in the stock market now, most people who work with the stock market on a daily basis, now believe, it's the prevailing opinion, that it's rigged. The majority of people who work with the stock market believe it's rigged. And some of us, you know, rigged is kind of an interesting word. You know, the game is rigged, the contest is rigged, you know, when they talked about Miss America contest being rigged, you know, it's fixed. And they all already know that there's so many transactions that are occurring, the technology has got so great that they can do all these trades and transactions in milliseconds. And basically, they've got a lot of robots now that they're working with. And there are some people behind the robots, but basically, the prevailing belief, they said, is that the stock market is rigged. And with that belief that it's rigged, then people go, I don't want to invest. So they were talking about, like, with certain sector, there's $300 billion less investments because people are getting fed up with everything. Now, even fed up, do you believe it? Fed up with the stock market, the biggest gambling joint in town, and how much the ego loves to gamble, and it's starting to get fed up with the stock market even? It's getting dissatisfied. So basically, when you start to hear stories like that, you start to realize that it's not, the faith is not the problem. It's like, what have I invested in? So the first thing I would say to anyone who wants to make the spiritual turn, give your life over to God, you know, like people feel a calling, like Mother Teresa did on her train when she was taking a train through India. That's when she got her calling. Everybody, you know, it doesn't, you don't have to be called to be a nun or a convent, in the convent, or a priest or a monk, but we can feel that calling, and I think it's a calling to divest in ego beliefs and invest in the guidance of the Holy Spirit. That's, to me, what the turn is. divest of all beliefs and that any of the ego's beliefs and laws have ever served me. Mm-hmm. You know, money, possessions, you know, achievements, accomplishments, intelligence, education, I mean, everything. Take all the ones that, you know, even the people go, oh, don't, oh, please don't. Baseball, hot dog, apple pie, and Chevrolet. You have to start to realize all those things have been part of a mesmerism to have your faith be invested in something in which you will not benefit at all. It's part of a death wish, and when you make the turn, all you're doing is you're saying, how have I poorly invested, and how can I change my tune, change my direction, and turn to the spirit? And to me, that's really what the turn is. Now, practically speaking, that starts to mean that you're going to have to seemingly be given guidance to take steps to unwind from the world. And it is divest. It's not, you know, in the ultimate sense, we're everything, but not in awareness. If we still have beliefs that we are sustained by all these beliefs in the world, then we do need to go through a divestment period. And to me, that's important in the turn. And Jesus even calls it relinquishment. You know, you'll go through a period of relinquishment, he says, in the stages of the development of trust. Yes?
There seem to be some things in the world that you have to continue to pay attention to. For instance, my big issue is exercise. And I've got to do exercise. You know, because I can't live without exercise.
Oh, you probably haven't heard all my talks for these last 20 years on, but I talk a lot about exercise, actually. I really do. I talk a lot because when this body seems to be much younger in time, yeah, I was into a lot of exercise. I mean, not just sports, baseball and tennis and basketball and golf and I joined the gym and you know, a lot of cardiovascular fitness and training.
Well, see, that's the opposite. I don't want to do it.
Yeah, you don't want. Well, this is just the start though, because I got into it, and then when I started into the mind training, actually when I started with the course in the mind training, I belonged to a club, a fitness club, and I started to ask, what is it for with everything? And when I was doing the course, it was like focusing all my attention on my mind training. And really, there was no attention on my body training at all. And so when I started to ask, what is it for, Jesus would tell me, he said, well, I'm going to use what you believe in. And so instead of spending so many hours on weights and cardiovascular training, I would still occasionally get guided to go to the fitness center. But I was having all these holy encounters, and all this stuff was pouring out of my mouth, and it felt really wonderful. But I wasn't getting a lot of exercise then. And then, as I continued on, I would have sometimes thoughts like, well, you know, without exercise, the muscles will atrophy, and, you know, I'll just kind of shrivel up. And you know what? That's a joke, too, because I went through this so many years ago. This was probably, 20-some years ago. And I haven't had a thought of exercise, actually, for a couple decades. I don't even think of it.
But I can't breathe well, and maybe it's just fear, I don't know. I can't breathe well, you know, when I.
It's like a cause-effect thing. It's like we start to think, I can't breathe well without the exercise. But the Holy Spirit's so practical that as we start to give our mind over, we more start to ascend in those thoughts that we're being given, you know, from the Spirit. It's more like things just start to gently just kind of fall away and drop away. Like, I've had this talk about exercise for many years in gatherings. People would say, don't you exercise? I said, oh, I don't even think of it. I don't even give a thought to it. And there has been no consequences, you know, like they used to tell us about, you know, when we're eating nutrition and the food groups and all this and this. My God, all the stuff that we are part of our belief system, you know, I found that it was the mind training that really brought me to health, because he says health is inner peace. He doesn't describe health in any terms in the course in terms of the body. In fact, he probably would say that healthy body is an oxymoron. Because he does even say at one point in the Course, don't ask the Holy Spirit to heal the body. Ask the Holy Spirit to heal your perception of the body. You see, the assumption is that the body needs to be healthy or could be sick. And both of those are judgments that are kind of projected onto it. So I think it's really practical. If you know, you were having difficulty breathing and you found a certain amount of exercise helped you breathe easier or something, we would say that's magical, but still it would just be more of a backdrop towards, while you're doing the mind training, to do what feels intuitive. I always tell people, eat intuitively. And if you believe in exercise, exercise intuitively. Don't kind of push yourself and force yourself. Really do it in an intuitive way. And I did have a friend one time who, he had a series of heart attacks. And he would come to me taking heart medicine, and he was exercising, and he was had a certain diet and everything. And I forget how he said, I just quit doing two of them, and I had a heart attack. And after the heart attack, I said, well, what did you do? He said, I went back to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit said, I didn't tell you to drop two of those. I told you to just drop the diet one. And then, you know, he kept going back before he had another heart attack. It was like, you know, really starting to tune in. He had like three heart attacks. But it was, he still used it for his mind training, you know. He was always going back to the Spirit, like, what did I do wrong? Oh, okay, all right, okay. You know, it was back and forth, not trying to jump the gun and just drop everything at once, because even though we made the ego and the ego made the world and we've kind of wound ourselves into the world, the Holy Spirit's the one who has to unwind us from the world. So I know I talk about a lot of things in my life, but they occurred over a lot of years. I was just doing the mind training and getting the guidance, and I would little by little, you know, put less attention on things. And I didn't immediately drop all my beliefs around nutrition. I didn't immediately drop all my beliefs around exercise, you know, or diet and things. But progressively, many things fell away as I gave my mind over to miracles. Yeah.